sense to add that. I think what would have been perhaps not appropriate is to have done all of those things without letting people know what exactly the app does. We don't do that. It's actually quite transparent to say exactly what the app does.
Right. Hi, Anna. Thanks for joining us.
Hi, my apologies. My desktop did not cooperate.
That's perfectly all right.
Yeah.
I had just asked Rahul about whether any app that has contact tracing as a feature should have other features involved in it, even if it's marketed as not a contact tracing app. So, Rahul, my second question on the basis of that was that the terms of service do say app is part of a service designed to enable registered users who have come in contact with other registered users who have tested positive for the severe blah 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 to be notified, traced, and suitably. Terms of use, sorry, the terms of service, as they are called, restrict the purpose to just contact tracing.
Not necessarily. I mean, I think the point behind the app is the purposes of the app are covered both in the terms of service as well as in the privacy policy. With regard to the information that's being collected, the information that's being collected is extremely clear. In fact, in my experience of doing this for nearly 2 decades, I've studied lots of privacy policies. I would challenge you to find the word etc. or the word including. This is usually what people put in privacy policies just because they want to leave room for other things that can be done in the future. This privacy policy actually does not use the word etc. anywhere. It is also a very, very limited and narrow privacy policy, and it says very clearly what can and cannot be done. So the nature of data collected, very clearly stipulated, the use to which it can be put, very clearly stipulated, and the duration of time for which that data continues to remain valid, both on the app as well as on the server, very, very clearly stated.
Right. So before I get into questions about data retention and data deletion, I'll just ask Arnab, how does the app work, especially in terms of contact tracing, and what are the different kinds of information collected? If you can give us a brief overview.
Absolutely. So I'm going to start from the very basics. The central spirit of the core of the product is contact tracing. Contact tracing is done through Bluetooth. When two devices that have Aarogya Setu app installed come in close proximity of each other, the two devices exchange a digital handshake of the signature of this interaction. What do we capture in this digital handshake is what are the two device IDs? When have these two devices met? What is the distance? For how long they have met? This is the primary purpose. So, and both the sets of information for both the devices are stored on and encrypted and stored on the device itself. The encryption key used for this encryption is the native OS encryption key, which is the most secure way to encrypt anything on a mobile phone. When it comes to information, there are three sets of information that the app collects. The first set of information is when you register, and assuming you're a first time registering, the app asks for your phone number, basis which it gives you an OTP and helps you register. Post that, it also asks you a very specific set of questions, which is what is your name, what is your age, what is your sex, what is your profession, where all have you traveled in the last 30 days, and whether you are ready to volunteer or not. This is a one-time exercise, and this gets stored securely on the server. The second piece of information, which is the most amount of information gathering through this app, is your Bluetooth contact tracing, and the parameters of that I have already detailed and given to you, which is stored on the phone itself. The third aspect is the self-assessment test, which is where, based on the ICMR guidelines, if any of these conditions apply to you, and that information is stored on the server. At the time of registration and at the time of self-assessment, your location is also securely stored on the server. At the time of your Bluetooth interaction, the location is stored on the device itself. So these are the three broad buckets of information that we request the user from, and all three have very sound logical backing of why we need these sets of information.
Okay. Can you please tell us which all agencies or government ministries is this data shared with, and in what format and how?
So, so I so I'm not going to name names of agency, department X, department Y, department Z. If you are following how India is addressing the COVID-19 pandemic, most of the work is multidisciplinary, multi-agencies. You have seen multiple empowered committees being created to deal with it. My simple answer to you is that the data that has been trusted with the citizens of India are only shared with people who are directly related with COVID-19 medical intervention and planning. And with a very, very implicit and clear understanding that only people that need to know the information, only people that need to know that specific part of information have been given access to the information to act for a very, very specific purpose. For example, if we have to share what is the possible risk of infection in, say, state X, only that state X gets that access and not state Y. So that is very, very clear. And from a central government perspective also, only the people directly involved in COVID-19 medical intervention or planning have an access to the data, nobody else.
Okay, before I get to data sharing, we talked about DIDs, that's device IDs. And my understanding is that they're static. Are there any plans to make them dynamic? Because we spoke to a number of technical experts who said that as with Trace Together, it would be better to have dynamic IDs. Even the Apple Google API would create dynamic device IDs, and it is a scalable model.
Yeah, so I think that's a very good point of view. Even the Aussie app that came in yesterday also has a dynamic ID generated every 2 hours. For now, Arogya Setu gives one-time randomized anonymized device ID, which is paired to your phone number. We are not dynamically generating this yet, but that's a good suggestion. We will table this with our set of people, the decision makers, and see if we can move in that direction.
Okay. Now, vis-a-vis data sharing, can you tell me how the app would work if supposing I were to test COVID-19 positive and I have the app?
So, see, the single source of what we have been very, very clear is that we should not have multiple source of truths for anything related to medical intervention. There has to be a single source of truth. And the single source of truth is what is the definition of somebody turning COVID-19 positive? The definition of that somebody turning COVID-19 positive is that they have been tested at a clinic or a testing center, and that information is passed to the ICMR. ICMR gives us the details of anybody who has turned COVID-19 positive, and basis that we extract or pull the contacts made by that person in the last 14 days and calculate a risk of infection of all the other people who may have come in contact with this COVID-19 positive person.
Right. So over here, two questions. The first is, I think I've discussed that with you earlier, as ICMR would not have the device IDs of the people.
Yeah.
They would have the phone numbers.
Yes.
And when it comes to data collected at the time of registration, you have the PIC, includes your name, gender, phone number, age, profession, and travel history.
Yeah.
Right? So that's stored in one little site and encrypted on the government, wherever that may be.
Yeah.
Now, then that's hashed to a DID. And basically...
I do not know what you mean by hashed to a DID, but go on.
The policies.
Okay, keep going, yeah.
So basically the idea then would be that this silo of PII can be accessed only through this DID.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the idea? Am I correct?
No. So here is the thing that what you assume is that everything that is there is encrypted through one thing, or it's encrypted in one table. It's a wrong assumption. I'll tell you why. When you register your phone number, basically your phone number, your device ID is already assigned to you. This device ID, phone number is not a straightforward decryption that you can get anybody's. If I give you anybody's device ID, you can get anybody's phone number also. That's not an easy task. First of all, let me assure you that. The second thing is that the second set of information, which is the PII, is stored in a different table, in a different schema, which is not, again, directly linked to your phone number, etc. You have to understand that we have made sure that if one piece of information is available to you, you will not be able to construct other pieces of information. And that is any large mobile product, large tech product, best practices of encryption, etc. So when we get a phone number from ICMR, what we do is that, and I don't want to go into too much technical details because that is not my intention for people to understand. When we get someone's phone number, we go from phone number to an intermediate set of ID, and from an intermediate set of ID to the device ID is how we get the device ID. And when we get this device ID, we use this device ID that we have obtained on the server, because ICMR has given the information to us on the server and not on the phone. We pull this device ID, and then we using this device ID only and not any personal information, we pull the contact tracing of that person who has turned COVID-19 positive from the phone.
So is consent take, so if this is my device that we're talking about and I have tested COVID-19 positive, is consent taken from me?
Rahul, you want to answer that? This is already covered in the privacy policy.
Yeah, so I mean, essentially your consent is taken at the time that you sign up to the app. It's quite clearly stated in the privacy policy.
No fresh consent is taken for pinging my potential Bluetooth contacts or people whom I may have been in physical contact. No.
So if you look at the way in which the privacy policy is designed, essentially it says that the information is collected from you in two ways. First, it is collected from you when you register, and so that information goes up to the server. Secondly, that your DID information is collected from you by the phone of someone who comes close to you.
Right.
And so it resides on their device. Now, if that person becomes COVID positive, then that information on his phone is pulled up through this consent mechanism, which is that you have consented to provide your information to that other phone when it comes in contact with you. And also you understand that when that person test COVID positive, that this information goes up to the cloud.
Right. So in the Singapore...
The simple answer is there are multiple models. There are some models which say, and I'm not sure what the actual shape of the Apple-Google model is going to be, but from early indications, it seems that you can voluntarily upload your information up to the cloud at that additional point in time. It's possible that Singapore says the same thing. I'm not fully sure of Australia. I haven't looked at
that. Same thing.
I suspect they will do the same thing as well. This model is not that. This model is that when you turn COVID positive, that the information from your phone can be pulled up.
Okay. So wouldn't it, perhaps from a privacy perspective, in terms of granting agency to people, wouldn't it be better if the doctor already knows that other people tested positive. The doctor already knows what my number is. To get in touch with me, to ask me if I do, I consent to pinging the server, but it can directly, information about people who may have been in contact with me can be pulled up directly from there. That way I have consented to it. And it's a shorter for NIC and for ICMR to get to the contacts.
So, I mean, look, as I said, there are two models. This is the model that has been used in Singapore, Australia, as Arnab says, as well as in the Google Apple model. It's not the model that's been selected for this, but in both models, the pulling of information is with consent. So it is the basis of the pulling is with consent. The consent that you're talking about and the agency that you're talking about can be exercised. And if you look at all privacy policies for every data collection company, the privacy policy will say upfront that I will collect this information from you. It's also possible for us for Facebook to say, for us to say, look, wouldn't it be better for us to give the user more agency so that just before you serve him an ad, you can ask, do you want to be served an ad? But no one does it. So all I'm trying to say is that there are multiple models that exist. What would have been erroneous in this model is if there was no consent, but the proximity to when the consent was granted is certainly a feature that can be considered. But the fact that it is collected upfront is not necessarily dangerous. Now there are many considerations that went into actually taking a call for this. For instance, if there are circumstances under which the patient is suffering in a way that it is not possible for the patient to give consent. There are there could be various other considerations as well, and so that's sort of the basis for why it was done. Quite frankly, I don't know the decision. Arnab may know exactly why this sort of a decision was taken, which is, do we take it proximally or do we take it upfront? But you know, from a privacy perspective, my concern is, do we have consent to do it? And I believe that we do.
Arnab, would you like to comment on that?
No, I'll go with Rahul. So, see, there are multiple ways to do the same thing. We have chosen to go one way. That's having said that, we are not stuck. This is an evolving product and we are not stuck to a specific philosophy as long as the overall design principle and the privacy principle is respected, which is taking information with consent. The model that you are describing is also a good model, and we continuously keep evaluating what we need to do as a product to move in the right direction. So, I mean, we are evaluating these things. If it makes sense from our perspective, for a large implementation perspective, sure, we will take that into consideration.
Okay. So one thing that I had learned from my discussions with both of you is that there are algorithms at play to calculate the probability of risk, something both the privacy in terms of use talking, which for people who may not know how, what I've understood of it is that once I have tested positive and my information has been pinged in the server, so all the people I've been in contact with, say Rahul, Arnab, their DIDs have been pulled. Although at this stage, I know that it's actually Rahul and Arnab, they're probably identified ABC and XYZ. At that stage, an algorithm that runs on the basis of how long Rahul and Arnab were in my vicinity and whether that's a probable risk of infection. So if we just pass by in a park, chances of you getting infected from me are fairly low. But if we stood there with each other for, say, 20 minutes, that would be useful information. Now, over here, who created this algorithm?
I mean, the simple answer is, again, a set of people who understand mathematics, who understand statistics, population level statistics, epidemiology, medical doctors. It's not one person. I can't say person XYZ who is a genius behind all of this. It's a bunch of people who have come together. We have taken into consideration the advice from ICMR. What is the peak curve of risk of, I mean, number of days since turned positive, which is the peak of infection, what is the optimal distance of infection, etc. We have taken all those things into consideration. So I wish I could tell person XYZ built it, but it's a bunch of people who have come together and built it and continuously testing it over time.
And what's the rate of success of this kind of an algorithm? Because I'm also thinking in terms of that if two devices are placed next to each other, just the devices and not the people actually, then it would potentially lead to greater stress on health resources. On the other hand, if I leave my phone somewhere and go out walking, that won't necessarily register. So it may skew the models for testing. So how has that been into account?
So I'll tell you something. I don't want to reveal too much details because we will want to share all of these findings through an official release. But I'm going to tell you something which is very, very interesting, that we have found several early success stories on this already. The kind of conditions that you described are the conditions that no technology can solve for. So whether we want to start thinking about those things or whether we start thinking about the genuine cases is something that is more important for us. When two people are in close vicinity, we can model that up. Whether they have left their phones and have started walking somewhere else is something, I mean, tell me a technology that can solve for it. So we can solve for the, with the right intent for the right use cases. There can be several of these exceptions for which we can't solve, which means that we have to be very, very careful of the false positives and the false negatives that the algorithm may raise. And we are continuously evaluating and modeling our work basis these feedback. I'm not at the liberty to tell you the exact things because this should come as one consolidated update to the to everybody. And we will keep doing these kind of information sharing. In summary, very, very encouraging early results. What we have told you and what we are telling everybody, including the health officials, etc., is this is a probability of risk. This is not a possibility of risk. People need to understand that. the true indicator of whether you have COVID-19 or not is a test. What we are trying to do is help you with intelligence. And people should understand, including people in the civil society, we are not trying to solve everything through one app. It's not possible at all. It's a technology solution for intelligence.
Right. That was going to be my next question. Are there plans to supplement digital contact tracing that's offered by Arogya Setu with manual contact tracing? For instance, 4 states in the United States have earmarked millions of dollars for manual contact tracers, and each state is planning to hire about 1,500 actual humans to do this kind of contact tracing. So is that on the agenda?
So Rahul and I, we work on Arogya Setu. These are things that are beyond what we are trying to do. Manual tracing, as it is already happening, and our system has consolidated the information that we have got from manual tracing. Again, smartphone-based contact tracing can't replace manual tracing for a country as diverse as India. We have been working on several other things. Just in a few days, you will get to know, and we will release the Kai OS version of the Arogya Setu, which will work for another 100 million odd geo feature phones, which have an operating system and where some of the apps can work. We are also working on building an IVRS system, interactive voice response system, where people with feature phones can input information. So these are the ways. Our mandate is to find technology solutions, and there are policymakers who have the other mandates that you just described. So I will leave it to them, and not trying to solve everything through our app or through the limited number of people that are involved in Arogya Setu.
Fair enough. One thing that we talked about was the self-risk assessment test. There are at least 4 problems that I can think of with that. The first is that people can fib on the self-assessment test. So what kind of error tolerance is built into that? Second, many people use the same phone. So in some class households or lower middle class households, you'll have 4 to 5 people using the same phone. How do you account for that? Then third, data collection for syndromic testing, which is something that Rahul told me about, that there's something called syndromic testing. It requires certain kind of error tolerance as well. So what kind of error tolerance is there? And fourth, an app like Zomato has obligatory for its delivery agents to have Arogya Setu. And to regularly take the self-assessment tests there. So what are the chances that the delivery agents, just to continue earning their income or the tips, would lie on that test so that they're always free?
So I'm not going to answer on the intent of the people that are taking self-assessment. I'm not going to do that. Our request to everybody who is taking the self-assessment is to take the self-assessment test seriously, because this helps us in advanced planning and proactive measures for everyone's health benefit. Here is the thing. So this is the self-assessment test that we have got, and the people that have been that have self-assessed them as high risk. What we have done is that we have roped in a set of doctors to make follow-up calls to them and see whether the symptoms, etc., that they have indicated, whether that has persisted, whether they have worsened, or whether they have got better. So we already have started that work as of a few days ago, and we intend to cover all the people who assess them as high risk. And we want to make sure that in these difficult times, we have the requisite medical intervention from them wherever they are in this country. That's the whole idea behind this product, whether it be contact tracing or self-assessment. That is the whole idea behind it. And with that intent, with a positive intent, is what we are working on. I mean, if people are taking the test for fun, it's up to their conscience. Our request that please take this seriously, because this helps all of us together. Regarding the Zomato thing, it's upon Zomato to use the app in the manner they seem fit. We have not mandated anybody to make this mandatory, etc. And we hope everybody supports for extensive adoption of this. We are not explicitly asking anyone to make this mandatory yet.
Yet?
You catch on the words. I mean, see, it's not mandatory yet is all I can say. I mean, nobody knows this disease. So we can try to be an expert and start saying things right now, or we can focus on the things that are there. So one thing that I have requested to you is that there are multiple other things that nobody's interested in covering on the app. We get so stuck in privacy. We got to get so stuck in data security. My sense is this is one of the most inclusive apps that have come out anywhere in the world. I hope more people understand that and appreciate that it is an app that was available for at least Arnab, people from 12 languages.
I completely understand that and appreciate, which is what makes it all the more important to hold the app and its developers and the government accountable for it. Because as you had mentioned in a previous conversation, that when you're dealing with a denominator of 500 million people, even a boundary case becomes a use case.
Yes.
It's true for data security and privacy as well. So I wanted to move to the discussion about data retention and data deletion, which is something that I've discussed with both of you independently. Is uninstalling the app the same as deregistering or deleting the data?
Rahul?
So let me just answer a couple of privacy policy perspective, but I leave it to Arnab to talk about exactly how that works on the app. If you delete the app, the data will go. You also need to take care of is the registration data that is up in the cloud. Because when you do have the registration data that is when you do register, your information is collected and then pushed to the cloud immediately. In addition, there could be information that is pushed to the cloud from time to time. Essentially, if you come in contact with someone who has been tested positive, and as a result of this mechanism we mentioned, as a result of that, if the data gets pulled up. So the data deletion policy needs to address all of those things. So essentially, we've got a three-pronged attack as far as privacy is concerned. First is the anonymization, which we discussed upfront.
Right.
Second is the fact that for the most part, the data will remain on the device, which means if you just look at the percentages of people who test positive or who are COVID positive in the population, you're looking at relatively low numbers, and those numbers essentially could be 2 to 5%. So translate that into the actual number of people whose information will be pulled to the cloud. So if that is the case, then the vast majority of people, their data will remain on the device. The third leg then becomes, how do you ensure that once the information is no longer required, that information is not retained? So there is a very aggressive retention policy, which says that every 30 days it gets deleted off your phone. If it gets pulled to the cloud and you are not COVID positive, or you from the date that you uploaded to the cloud, 45 days later it gets deleted. And if you are COVID positive, 60 days after you are declared cured, it gets deleted. So at the end of this entire structure, there is no data that will remain on the cloud beyond when that data is necessary. In the 30-day period that we have taken, as you know, everyone looks for 14 days, a 14-day history, but we have information that the disease can persist 22, 28 days. 30 days has been picked from that perspective. If you look at it, there is a extremely robust data deletion mechanism. I think you can quibble with the duration of time, but I'm not medically equipped to be able to say whether it should be 14 or 30 or 60 or 90. But the point I hope people will appreciate is that there is once again a very strong data deletion process, which once again I will struggle to find other apps that have got this sort of a data deletion process. If there are ways to make it better, obviously we're looking to make it better, but there are certain parameters that have been provided to us by the entire team. And sorry to just get off topic for a minute, I wanted to pick up on something that Arnab said, which I know some of your listeners will be concerned about, and that is this this concern that this is technology solutionism, that we are trying to solve essentially a medical problem using an algorithm. We're not doing that. There is, of course, an algorithm, but that algorithm is an algorithm that's been put together by data scientists who have been working along with epidemiologists. So it's not like some boffin in the room came up with some algorithm that he fitted to a curve that was provided. It is it has been done in the presence of and in consultation with epidemiologists and medical people. And Arnab, correct me if I'm wrong, but we are constantly testing to see if the model is performing as we think it should be performing in the field. And so,
absolutely, some of the best epidemiologists, some of the best data scientists, some of the best population statisticians are involved in this process. We don't take these kind of things lightly.
So, in the there's one question from the viewers, and I think it's pertinent that we take it up, right? That it's an anonymous question. In the interest of transparency, would you be publishing the list of all entities and volunteers who participated in the development of Arogya Setu? Maybe not right now, maybe at a future day?
See, that is not my decision to take. I have been telling this to everybody that has asked me this question. People working on this app, people working on this mobile product are volunteers in individual capacity. They may be working with a firm. Rahul is working with a firm, but Rahul is an advisor to us.
I'm a volunteer.
Yeah, so Rahul is an advisor to us. He's a volunteer. Everybody is here in a voluntary capacity. It does not matter which entity they are, that they are. What we are trying to do is that we are trying to get the best of India to build an app which is for India. It's as simple as that. Where they work for is something that they are associated with. But let's not get stuck with that, saying that this company has built this company has built that. That is not the right way to think of it. The right way to think of it is that if India needed a technology solution to help with certain aspects of COVID-19, have the best of India come. They don't necessarily need to be from the government. So that shift of mentality and that shift of understanding has to be there. Is very, very important. If we needed the best legal mind in the country, we gave a shout to Rahul and we got it. We needed the best statistician in the country, we got that. And that is how we work. I mean, we can't take things to chance. So hence we need the best coders, the best program managers, the best product managers, the best legal, public policy, privacy people, and it doesn't matter where they work.
Okay.
And just one other thing. This is actually a request to all your listeners. I have sat in on many of your webinars, including the last one on COVID, as well as many others that are going around. I listen to a lot of, and read a lot of the papers that are coming out. And if people could actually point to problems, we will absolutely escalate it within the team and fix it. The idea really is to, and you know, we're not perfect. There could be some things and some combination of things that we didn't think about which exists. The idea really is not to hide behind the position that we put out. As you know, the privacy policy has already been amended. It will be amended again. Because as we figure out many of the inputs that are coming from Medianama as well as from papers that have been written, we will fix it because that really is the intention.
Okay, moving on to deletion once again. Why is the personal information stored on the server retained for 30 days even after you install the app? Because the idea is that, my Bluetooth data is uploaded to the source only if I get in touch with someone who's been COVID positive. My location data is also similar to the server in those circumstances. My self-risk assessment test would put, if I figure in yellow or orange, then of course someone will get in touch with me. So why retain my PII after I've deleted the app?
So, and once again, this is one of the inputs that we will take on from you. The way I would see it is, we could delete it immediately. We could delete it in 5 days, 10 days, 15 days, or 30 days. At this point in time, it is 30. If there is a good reason, and Arnab, we can even take it up within the committee to say there is a request that this be deleted sooner than 30 days. And you know, quite frankly, if it is possible, it will. I think the point to be noted, Aditi, and I'm glad you've pushed on the period of time, because it certainly, even to my mind, it wouldn't be okay if we had kept that data forever, which is quite frankly what a lot of people would do, or if we kept it for a year, because even a year is unacceptable. 30 days, to my mind, was not an impossibly long period of time, particularly if at the end of 30 days it was deleted. The question you're asking is 30 days too long? Can we make it, you know, 20 or 15 or 10 or immediately? I think immediately is unlikely to happen for various administrative reasons in the back end, which, you know, I don't know if Arnab can comment on, but essentially all this information goes into stratifying how the disease exists. And so it is actually important to get the number of people who are tested positive or who have a likelihood of being COVID positive stratified according to gender, according to profession. And if you look at the app, if you actually registered on the app, you'll find that the professions that are mentioned are not lawyer. I mean, the lawyer does not feature there. What features there is grocery people, frontline health workers. These are the people who are at risk in this particular time. And also during lockdown, these are the people who are likely to move around and who are likely to come in contact with people. And so we in the app actually do want to know how the disease stratifies across demographic lines. And that's the reason why it's there. So at the time at which it needs to be pulled out, at this point in time it's 30, it could be less. But all I'm trying to say is that it actually does get deleted. And that is the important takeaway.
So what happens if I test positive for COVID after deleting the app, but my personal information is still stored on the server? What happens in that case? I don't have the app on my phone anymore. But NIC, of course, has my data on the server. None of my Bluetooth data or location data, except at the time of registration, has been uploaded. So is it possible that the government...
So if there is no data, so essentially, and Arnab will correct me if I'm wrong, but essentially with that whole translation of the mobile number to the DID, they will then try to pull the information from your device. But if it doesn't exist on your device, they can't pull it from your device.
Yeah.
So as far as the app is concerned, all the people who you have come in contact with as a COVID positive person now can't be notified because that information no longer exists on your phone to be able to pull. That's the simple answer because, you know, as far as that purpose of the app is concerned, it is essential for the app to be installed and live and for you to have actually used it as you were walking around in order for that feature to be...
Absolutely. I mean, the simple thing is, if you have been tested COVID-19 positive, you give us your phone number, we extract your DID, and we see that the DID is no longer active. I mean, we are not going to pull information from your device because that DID link from the server to your phone is dead now.
And does that... is that DID perhaps regenerated after 30 days have lapsed? So for instance...
No. See, that does not happen. We are not going to reuse DIDs. We have enough, it's 8 bytes of information. We have enough permutation to cater to the entire country. That's not going to happen, no.
Okay. So given that the disclosure that Arogya Setu tweeted about yesterday on Twitter, there's a question from one of the viewers. Manasa, what protections does a user have against personal data breaches? The terms of use state that the government of India will not be liable for unauthorized access to personal information. Would this imply limited recourse in case of breach?
Rahul, you want to answer? From my perspective, from what we have put yesterday, there has been no personal data breach.
Right.
So yesterday's announcement essentially was, so we were notified and it's all sort of clear in the notification that we put out that there was a vulnerability. That vulnerability was fixed pretty much immediately. Once again, as a good data practice, the details of that and the fact that we have fixed it was actually made public. I think there's one thing, Aditi, that you've got to appreciate. We do not have a privacy law today. And in nothing under our privacy rules is there any mention of data breach notification. The right. entire app has been functioning on the best privacy principles in the absence of specific details as to what needs to be done. Now, if you look at countries around the world, data breach notification is a sophisticated topic. Depending on what time, what information you have, there are various different reporting obligations. In India, we do not have anything of that level of sophistication other than notifying certain And if you're a privacy professional, you understand that the layers of nuance in a data breach are so sophisticated that it is just very trivial to expect that is the fulfillment of the obligation. But the entire app has been done based on privacy principles that are, I would say, meeting best in class principles. And this notification yesterday was not required, but was done. And we hope if any such thing gets pointed out to us, first of all, we'll fix it as soon as we can. And secondly, we'll let you know.
Perhaps the privacy policy can include data breach disclosures or vulnerability disclosures.
Yes, yes, and we will.
Okay, since Rahul talked about the PDP bill, and I know that you have to go. If the current PDP bill in its was a law, would the privacy policy measure up to it?
I don't know. You tell me. I think it's pretty good. It hits most of the points. So first of all, it's as you know, the PDP bill right now is a set of principles. A lot of the PDP bill in its implementation is going to be down to the codes of practice and the various other regulations that the Data Protection Authority is going to enforce. Hmm. Even at this stage, I think that as far as the principles are concerned, this privacy policy hits most of them. And you know, when I say most, I'm just being a lawyer. I can't figure out the one that we may not have, but as a lawyer, I've learned very well not to make statements that aren't appropriately caveated.
Let me ask you about that. I asked this question as well. Do the volunteers have a contract in place with the government? So was no. So the volunteers have a contract. The volunteers for that purpose then are their processors. According to the PDP bill, I understand that it's a bill right now, not an act. Work that's done by processors will have to be mandated through contract.
So what data is being collected by the volunteers?
The volunteers
at this point in time are responsible for designing the code. The code then runs through the government, and you have a direct contract with the government as far as the data collection is concerned. Personal data collection happens by the app. The app is an app put out by the government of India, which then collects that information. The volunteers in the process of building the app don't really access the personal information directly.
I don't think the bill is about accessing. And this is a question that she had also.
No, but ask a specific question, Aditi. Because that when you're collecting personal data, essentially what you are doing is you are collecting, and that is the volunteers, or let's just say me, is actually collecting personal information about, let's say, you, and then processing it in some way, which is storing it, transferring it, doing something with it. I've never seen anyone's data, and none of the volunteers will, because the point of the volunteers is they're building the code that does this. Then after that, the data is stored on the servers of the NIC. The data that is collected for COVID positive people are collected on a completely different channel, because those are medically collected. That's collected by ICMR. There is a doctor patient privilege, and then there are the ICMR regulations with regard to how that information goes up to ICMR in Delhi. So the who is collecting personal data in the middle of, which volunteer is collecting personal data in the middle of, this is what I want to think.
Or even processing. So no volunteers at all are processing, doing, collecting.
No, why would we? I mean, look, we're talking about 77 million people right now. We don't have 77 million, you know, we don't have data centers filled with call center people that are pouring through the details of 77 million people. That's why you've done an app. Because, see, the alternative would be to do manual contact tracing, which we discussed earlier. Hmm. Manual contact tracing is prone to mistakes, and therefore you've automated it. So in a sense, the app is adding to what you could always do by manual contact tracing. So manual contact tracing, someone's coming from Spain, lands at the airport and tests COVID positive. The doctor will say, retrace your path. He'll say, look, I came from the airport, then I went home, then I went to the market, then I went to the...
For interrupting you, it's just that we have a lot of questions to go through. And I just wanted to perhaps comment on this. What kind of security constraints are placed to ensure that personal data doesn't go outside of approved government employees, if you can quickly answer that?
Okay, I'm rushing. It's a very simple answer. Everybody who has access to the data is through a secure VPN tunnel on a need to know basis through an authentication mechanism. We know at any point in time if anybody is accessing what information, we have a log for that. These are standard best practices which we have followed. We have not diluted any of the standard best practices, nor we have built something which is out of this world. This is how sensitive data is handled, and which is exactly what we are doing.
Right. Okay, and you had also mentioned that there are methods in place to know if someone downloads personal data.
I just mentioned that we have logs of access of information. Again, this is a standard best practice when you're dealing with sensitive information.
And only government employees have access to personal data to begin with.
So yeah.
Personal volunteers get access to it. Now,
as Rahul mentioned, yeah.
Okay, Rahul, a question for you, and this is something that we've discussed. Rohan has asked in the chat, is there a chance that Arogya Setu will still be functional post-corona? Given that, now, we have discussed sunset provisions, and we've talked about data deletion, but the app itself doesn't seem to come with an expiry date, especially with more features being tacked on, given that it's not a contact tracing app. So, what do you have to say to that?
So, let me answer that, and Rahul can then add to that. See, it's very simple. The central spirit of the product is contact tracing. It's a temporary solution to a temporary problem. Mm. However, we do not want to rule out a situation where this app has become popular for people to use. It has become intuitive for people to use, so that tomorrow we can peel out the COVID-19 related information and still keep the app for other related information for which we are not collecting these kind of sensitive data. For example, we are going to add the telemedicine part. If this channel becomes important from a telemedicine perspective, why do we kill this medium if it's already being used by people? If this becomes a primary building block for a comprehensive health stack for the country, and we remove all the COVID-19 related information with all the sunset clause that we already have in place, it's an idea worth considering.
And all the data across different features is completely siloed from each other. So whether you have e-passes, API, or you have the self-risk assessment test, or you have your location Bluetooth data, or you have what kind of content I'm watching on the Trending Now section, which will be introduced later. So all of that.
Yeah, again, best practices of building a modular product. This happens across every product. This is happening here as well. Everything that you see, what you see when telemedicine comes out is that it's an app which goes, let the telemedicine part come and you'll understand what I mean by modular, what I mean by silos of information, what I mean by how easy it becomes to peel out the COVID-19 related information.
Fair enough. Rahul, do you want to add something here?
All I would say is that the privacy policy reads as it is. If there is any other feature that collects personal information, we will not include that feature without actually amending the privacy policy and getting consent to add that feature. That's once again a standard practice with regard to new features added.
That wasn't actually implemented this time around. When V2 came around, people weren't notified until 4 days later.
No, I know that. And we will fix that for when V3 comes. Look, you've got to understand that, and Arna will tell you this again, the team is burning the candle at both ends. When this incident happened yesterday, we fixed it at 4 a.m. Yesterday morning, right? And this is not, we don't have the resources of a Microsoft to throw at a project like this. This is a bunch of volunteers. I think a lot of them are in different parts of the country, and quite frankly, in lockdown, it doesn't even matter because no one can go to office. We will ensure that that the consent will be obtained when an amendment is made.
Okay.
And actually, Aditi, I may have to jump off. I have, I think, 3 minutes left for you.
Sure. So I'll quickly go to the audience questions from the viewers. Anth has asked, has the data related to sequences collected in versions now been deleted? Were the users notified?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that, Aditi. Was that for me or was that for Arnab?
Either of you can answer. So in the first version of that, in addition to the 6 strands of PII, there was also a question about whether you smoke or are a smoker. So now, has all that data been deleted, given that that's not a question anymore? And if yes, were the users notified about it?
So I don't know specifically if we have gone into the database and pulled out smokers' information. I think as far as the privacy policy is concerned, there is a new privacy policy which essentially says that from here on, this is the information that we will collect. I don't think the privacy policy has clearly stipulated that your smoking information will be deleted. Quite frankly, that information, when we put it in the earlier version, was thought to be relevant. It's not thought to be relevant, and so we don't collect that going forward.
And then again, we have a sunset clause. If it's not explicitly deleted, and I'm going to go and check that, it will get deleted.
Okay.
In a defined period of time.
Okay. Then Rahul Sharma from Perspective has asked, government has come out with, the government hasn't come out with data protection guidelines or an act to be observed, unlike other countries. Should sectoral regulators then step in?
This is a question that you should ask them. I mean, Rahul, you can answer.
My only point to this is, you know, let's not try and get sectoral regulators in. We need a privacy law. And Rahul knows this as well as I do. The focus of all of us on the call needs to be to get that law out. I don't think bringing sectoral regulators is going to help if we don't have the basic law in place.
Okay. Then Srinivas Kodali has asked, what is the liability on volunteers in case of security incidents?
What security incident?
Any security incidents.
I don't know. That's a difficult legal question. In order for there to be a liability on a volunteer, you would need to actually invoke some provision to say that you are the one who has done, who has sort of put this code together, and so you would be liable. I'm struggling to find a scenario when we will be doing that. I think the government will be the first port of call. I doubt very much that in any legal scenario, if there's faulty code, that you will go lift the veil of the government and go down to the actual volunteer who did this and hold him liable. I'm wondering whether that's the question he's asked, but that's the only way I can interpret that question.
Also, given the absence of any contracts between the volunteers and the government, I would think allocation of responsibility in this case would be difficult. And clause 7 in terms of service, where the government doesn't bear any liability.
Yeah, so look, I mean, Aditi, we can get into the details of all of this. I'll tell you this simply. As a lawyer who defends these sorts of cases, if there is a breach which has dire consequences, I don't think these sorts of provisions come in the way of courts when they want to do justice. And so to answer specifically Srinivas's question, I doubt very much that this is going to be, the liability is going to be vested on the individual volunteers. But these are really, far out remoteness of damage questions, which we can certainly get into. But, I would hesitate to provide an answer unless I have the specific facts, circumstances of the case to see how actually it will work in those circumstances. Quite frankly, we've got many more complicated problems that we haven't thought about. And I don't know why she's asking this question. I'm just thinking, what about the copyright? Because we need a contract for the copyright. But look, we put this together. I also was brought in, Arnab, I think maybe about a week after or 2 weeks after the project started, maybe a week after. And look, in an ideal world, you would actually put out an RFP and build this all out.
Yeah.
The fact that it's been built in this manner, and the fact that it has still adhered to so many privacy provisions, I think, is commendable. I would really urge people to look at other government products and compare the level of rigor that this product follows, particularly under dire circumstances.
Rahul, I think pass up.
Not just government apps. I'm going to say any app. I mean, you have on average 40 apps on your phone. Go and look at the privacy policy. Go and look at the amount of information they collect versus what we are collecting. We are collecting bare minimum. We can all go and keep reading, say, 2,000 words that are in terms of service and 5,000 words that are in privacy policy through a microscope. I think we are missing the bigger picture by focusing too much on this. And sorry, Aditi, this may sound slightly crude, but we are missing the bigger picture. The bigger picture is that we are in the middle of a pandemic. Everybody should be coming together to find a solution for this. One of the ways this can be done is through technology, and this is why you need an app which actually automates and takes away the pressure from a lot of people in trying to fight this disease. I mean, these are 7,000, 8,000 words. Let's keep going over a microscope and let's keep devoting so much time on it, which is fine, but also devote several other features which I was trying to address earlier. This is the most inclusive app that the India will see. We are already live in 12 languages. We have an intent to go to all 22 languages plus English. This is already working at a 77 million level, could work at a 400 million level. The UI UX is extremely easy to use. Anybody in rural India, urban India can use it in their native language. There are images, there are bold text, there are best practices. We are updating the content every day. We are moving the right direction, both in terms of service and privacy, as far as that is concerned. We are on a daily basis updating how we are going forward. We have proactively reached out to people who may be at high risk and trying to give them the advice from a doctor. These are the things that people should be focusing on and trying to help us make this better, rather than getting fixated on 7,000 lines of terms of service and public privacy policy till the time that cows come home.
Sorry, I want to jump in because I actually have to jump off. Before I do that, I want to say actually, I'm really glad that you did this. I'm glad that you have given us an opportunity to get questions from so many people. And I really appreciate the way in which civil society has been pushing us with questions to try and fix this. I think we are, I certainly am committed to looking and reading every single question. We may not be able to implement everything, but the intention is to absolutely consider everything, and we do. And this gets considered, debated at a very intense level. Believe me, we don't have Saturdays and Sundays. We consider it greatly in detail. I have to jump for a very mundane reason, which is that my son has an online class right now, and he needs to use this computer. So it's got nothing to do with anything else. We're also juggling all of these things at this time. But thank you very much for doing this. Look, you know, if there are other iterations, we will, I speak for myself, happy to come on and go through this again to give people comfort as to what we're doing.
Sure. Would it be right? There are a number of questions that viewers have asked. Would it be all right if I said email those questions to both of you?
Please, my monologue was in no way trying to tell you not to discuss privacy. It's just that please focus on other features also.
That's perfectly fine. Rahul, I know that you have to go. We had one, I think we can end with this question, to be honest. The question is from Sri Kodali. Is there a push for a single source of truth? What does it even mean? Where is it even defined in government documents?
I mean, see, that is a terminology I have used to know who all are conclusively COVID-19 positive. I mean, so don't pick on phrases. I mean, we need to know for sure who is COVID-19 positive or not. And the only way to do that is somebody has conclusively gone through a test and has been declared positive. And that information in this is then collated at the ICMR level. And we are just making sure that we get the information through right channels, and we don't start seeding in a lot of false positives into the system. So that's just the best practice that we have used, which is we get it vetted from a trusted agency which has been entrusted to do this work at a country level, and we pick the information through an API to our system through a trusted agency. That's all.
Right. Thank you, Arnab. Thank you, Rahul. It was great to agree to be a part of a public interview. There are a number of questions that are still left. I'll email those to you. And thank you for being a part of it.
Thanks a lot for doing this, Aditi. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Arnab. Thank you, Rahul.
Sorry, I couldn't stay on. You know that I usually stay on for Media Number events. And I wanted to know, where do I get my book? Because I only come for these events because of the free book, Nikhil.
I did not know about this, but sign me in also for that.
Well, to get into semantics, this wasn't an event, but an interview. Yes, both your books will await you once the lockdown is lifted so that we can courier them to you or in person. And you can choose your books.
All right. Okay. Thanks.
Okay.
Thank you. Thanks, guys.
Tuning in. Thank you.
Hi, sorry.